All right. This KV Pivot 2018 paper 1 to 7 we discussed in the previous class. So 8 onwards I need to discuss. If you read the 8th question carefully, let A equal to cos 1 degree, B equal to sin 1 degree. They gave that, leave that. Now what they said is they are defining something. We say that a real number is algebraic. Okay, we can say a number is algebraic if it is a root of a polynomial with integer coefficients. If there is a polynomial equation where all coefficients are integers, some roots may be rational, some roots may be irrational. In irrational numbers, there are two types of numbers. Some numbers can be roots of a polynomial with integer coefficient or real numbers. Some numbers can, they can never be roots of a polynomial with integer coefficient. For example, if it is e, pi, they are all called transcendental numbers. Okay, that is because they are not they are irrational numbers, but within irrational numbers they cannot be roots of a polynomial with integer coefficients. But if we take example like thirds, 2 + √3, 2 - √3, I'm sure we can find a polynomial with them as the roots. So anyway, here they are defining, if you are able to find a polynomial with the given number as the root, and the polynomial should have all integer coefficients, that kind of a real number is called algebraic. If you cannot find such a polynomial where integer coefficients are not there, that means it is not a root of a polynomial with integer coefficients, then we say it is not algebraic. Okay. So they are asking cos 1 degree. Can you frame a equation where all coefficients are integers and cos 1 degree is a root of that, or sin 1 degree is a root of that? Okay. So one thing in trigonometry is in the beginning, the trigonometry formulas can be derived from the basic definition of cos theta, sin theta. But lot of other higher properties are derived using complex numbers. If you actually take the very old book on trigonometry, plane trigonometry, S.L. Loney, it has two parts, volume 1, volume 2, part 1, part 2, whatever it is. The part 1 is based on the original definition, but part 2 all are derived using complex numbers. At least we have an exercise. So I want to give an idea about it. So those who don't know about complex numbers, you will not understand now, but you'll get a glimpse of it. Okay. And later on, after complex number theory is covered thoroughly, you can go back and can come back and see this. Okay, so let me explain this. This is actually called De Moivre's theorem. I'm just stating cos n theta plus I is a complex number root minus 1 or iota plus sin n theta is actually cos theta plus I sin theta whole power n. That you have to learn from complex numbers. Now from here to here, I'm using binomial theorem. A plus B whole power n, nc0 a power n, nc1 a power n minus 1 into b, nc2 into a power n minus 2 into b square, so on. When you expand everything, some are rational terms, some are real part, some are imaginary part. Here I is there. Here I square will be minus 1. Later on I cube will be minus I. Wherever I is there, I separated. Wherever I is not there, I separated. This is called a real part. This is called imaginary part. Now when I equate these two, this whole thing will be this real part cos n theta. When I equate this to this one, this is cos n theta plus I into sin n theta. This is something plus I into something. This whole thing is real part. This is real part equated. That is this. This whole thing is imaginary part. This imaginary I equated. I got two equations. Actually, this and this are not relevant for the present question. I don't need it. But I'm just using this as an excuse to tell something. This is cos n theta. This is sin n theta. If you want tan n theta, sin n theta by cos n theta. This by this. But nowhere tans are there. Why did I write tan? After taking this by this, everywhere I divided with cos theta whole power n. I divide here with cos theta whole power n. This also cos theta whole power n. This. When I divide with cos theta whole power n, cos theta power n minus 1 will cancel. I'll get sin by cos tan. Here I'll get tan cube, tan power 5. Here 1. Here tan square, tan power 5. Okay. I'm sure if you go back and see your first year material also, we gave this formula tan n theta equal to this, but we did not explain there how it came because we don't know about complex numbers. Okay, so sometimes we are going to use this formula later on. Okay, when you revise trigonometry at higher level. Now I want to use only this. Don't worry about this and this for the time being. If somebody says, try to make a polynomial with all integer coefficients such a way that cos 1 degree is a root of that. If I take theta as 1 degree and n as 60 and put it here, this will become cos 60 1 by 2. This will become cos 1 degree, sin 1 degree, cos 1 degree, sin 1 degree. NC0, NC2, NC4, you know, they're all integers. If I take 60C0, 60C2, 60C4, they're all integers. One may say here 1 by 2 is there, no problem. Send 2 that side, send 1 that side. We'll get a polynomial called integer coefficients. And if I take cos 1 degree as x, that is the root of this because equal to 0 is coming when you embrace and that side. One may say sine is also there.
Yes, sir.
Sine square theta, you can write 1 minus cos square theta.
Yes.
Sine power 4, you can write 1 minus cos square theta whole square. Sine power 6, you can write 1 minus cos square theta whole cube. So all sine can be removed and can be converted into cos. So when you expand the whole thing, in fact, you write cos theta as a. And sine square theta, which is 1 minus cos square theta, you write 1 minus x square. So wherever cos theta is there, you write a or even x. And wherever sine square theta is there, you write 1 minus x square. When you substitute it, definitely you'll get a polynomial of nth degree whose root is cos 1 degree. If you don't like 60, you directly take 90, it is more easier. Because if theta is 1 degree, n is 90, n theta is 90 degree, cos 90 degrees is 0, you'll get everything 90. Equal to 0 is also there, and do this. Wherever cos theta is there, write x. Wherever sin square theta, you write 1 minus x square. You will get a polynomial of nth degree equal to 0. And what is satisfying is cos 1 degree, which is a root of that. In fact, for that, sine 1 degree is also root for the same equation. How? You take sine theta as x, and wherever cos square theta is there, you write 1 minus sine square theta and write 1 minus x square. Then you'll get a maybe apparently slightly different polynomial, but for that sine 1 degree is the root. So you can convert this whole thing into only in terms of sine, or only in terms of cos, up to you. Either you can write sin square theta as 1 minus cos square theta, or cos square theta as 1 minus sin square theta. Then you are getting a polynomial with integer coefficients where cos 1 degree is a root or sin 1 degree is a root. Is it clear? All of you are able to relate to this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Actually, whatever equation that you got, not cos 1 degree is a root, cos 3 degrees is also a root. Why? 90 into 3 is 270, and cos 270 is also 0. Cos 5 degrees is also root. So this is, for example, if you take n equal to 90, it is a 90th degree equation. All the 90 roots of that also can be told. They are cos 1 degree, cos 3 degree, cos 5 degree, cos 7 degree. Okay? Like that you can take, we'll be able to tell you. Is it fine?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So that is this question. They're basically asking, do you have any polynomial? I'm showing on the screen, basically. Do you have any polynomial where all coefficients are integers and cos 1 degree is a root of that? If you have, it is algebraic. If you are not able to think, make something of that sort, it is not algebraic. So we are able to find one equation where cos 1 degree is also root and sin 1 degree is also root of that. So both of them are algebraic. Okay, this is the 9th question. Okay, if somebody wants to copy from the board, I can give some time. I think in another KVPY, they asked about tan 1 degree. So that's why I told you tan and theta, where you can take something there and find it. Okay. Later on, you can just, this basically I'm giving hint. I'll not be able to give too much time to copy and all. As long as you understand, you can see the recording once again, or you can try with the hint. Okay, ninth question is a calculus question. Maybe by some quadratic question also can be done, depending on what expression you come. Y equal to x square minus 4 is a parabola with 2 and minus 2 are the roots. And at 0 it is minus 4. 2, 4. Okay, so this is a parabola y equal to x square minus 4, where this point is 0 comma minus 4, 2 comma 0, this is minus 2 comma 0. There's a parabola y equal to 4 minus x square, negative of this and that 2 by 2. That is not the as height as this, little less height than this one. It will be like this. Y equal to 4 minus x square. That is also intersecting at x-axis at same places, but this is 0, 2. They like two parabolas of more opening and less opening. A rectangle with sides parallel to x and y-axis is inscribed in a region. Yeah. So I can put a rectangle like this, or I can put a very flat rectangle like this. If I take a rectangle where it is very lean like this, you can see the width is very less, height may be a lot, but practically it is a very lean, less area. If I take a lot of width, I'll get a rectangle like this, practically area will be tending to zero somewhere. So when you take two points very close and construct a rectangle, very zero. As you increase, area will increase. And finally, when you take a very broad rectangle, also area is zero. Somewhere you'll have maximum. What is that maximum value? Okay, let us take this rectangle. Take some point here as x coordinate is x and y coordinate is 4 minus x squared by 2. From symmetry, it is minus x comma 4 minus x squared by 2. This is same x coordinate as this, x comma x squared minus 4. This is minus x comma x squared minus 4. Okay, so what is this one? 2x. This is x, this is x squared. What is this one? This y coordinate minus this y coordinate. So from this, when I subtract this, I will get 3 by 2 times 4 minus x square is this height. Okay. 4 minus x square by 2 minus x square minus 4 is 3 by 2 times 4 minus x square this height. So what is the area? I hope they wanted maximum area. Rectangle. The maximum possible area of such a rectangle is closest to what? Okay. So what is the area? Width is 2x. This length. This is 3 by 2 times 4 minus x square. Of course, x belongs to closed interval minus 2 to 2. In fact, I should say except 0 also. Because if you take 0, there is no rectangle. Not even closed to open. Where x can be anything between minus 2 to 2, not 2. I can even take 0 to 2 also, nothing wrong, because if I cover on the right side, automatically fall in. Okay. So it is simple for cubic. Okay, you can find the derivative and equate it. Not a problem. 2 to 2 will cancel 3x inside 4x minus x cube. What is dA by dx? 3 into 4 minus 3x squared and equate it to 0. X will come root 4 by 3. And you put it back, the corresponding area, which is maximum, is 3 into, better I will substitute in this, 3x into 4 minus x square is 3 into root over 4 by 3 into 4 minus 4 by 3. This is 8 by 3. So 8 into root over 4 by 3. If you want, you can take even inside this, just to know the nearest integer. 64 into 4, 256 by 3. If I write that as mixed fraction, I'm sure you'll have some calculator, you can do it. Otherwise, 3 8s are 24, 16, 3 5s are 15. It is 85 plus 100. It is around root 85, which is 9 point something. Root 81 is 9, so a little more than. Yeah, so the closest integer is 9. 10 is also there, but I don't think it is close to 10. It's between 81 to 100, it is close to 81 than 100. Is everybody clear about question number 9? What is the question and what we have done? Anybody has doubt? What is the
question? Yes.
I should explain what is the question. Okay.
Oh, yes.
Basically, what happened is there is one parabola like this, little less height. There is another parabola, little more deep. But both parabolas are intersected at x-axis. Between these two, you have to insert a rectangle. You can insert a rectangle like this, or a rectangle like this, or a rectangle like this. Okay. But their sides should be parallel to x-axis and parallel to y-axis. Among all those rectangles, which one has maximum area? That's the question. So I took this point, which is on this curve, x coordinate is x and y coordinate is 4 minus x squared by 2. It's a mirror image of that with respect to y-axis is x coordinate for minus 6. Same x coordinate if I put in this curve, y equal to x square minus 4 here, x coordinate is this, y coordinate is this, but it's a negative actually. You take this y coordinate minus this y coordinate, get the height. This is x, this is x, this is 2x. You know this length, you find the area. In first year calculus, how will you find maximum or minimum value of any expression? You find the derivative of that equal to 0, and then you are supposed to find second derivative and substitute that point and see whether it comes negative or positive, come negative maximum, positive maximum. Or you can look at the sign change. But whatever it is, you find the first derivative equal to 0, you get some x value. Those x values put it back in the original function, you'll get local maxima or local minima. Is it okay now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, both 10 and 11 are about differentiability. Okay, as I said earlier, don't have to prepare specifically for KVPY. It is as good as your JEE mains or advanced preparation or in between. But if you, after doing few papers, you can see which questions are coming or which topics are coming more repeatedly. I think continuity and differentiability is one topic that's coming quite often. Okay, or some particular integration may be coming, or some differential equations, or complex numbers. If you can notice and you spend a little more time, maybe you can do that. Okay, so I'm going to erase this whole thing on the board. Okay, basically how to check continuity and differentiability. We have many functions, standard functions, which are continuous and differentiable. For example, polynomial, sine x, cos x, and rational functions where denominator is not zero. We know they're continuous and differentiable. And if a function is continuous, when you apply mod also, it will be continuous only. Okay. It cannot make a continuous function into discontinuous function. It can make non-differentiable because there can be a sharp change. For example, sine x versus mod sine x. Sine x is very nicely differentiable here, but when I take mod, that is because the slope is minus 1. When I take mod, it will come like this. The right-hand derivative slope of tangent here, left-hand derivative slope of tangent here, they are different. It will not be differentiable there. So when mod is there, we have to be a little careful there only. Otherwise, at other points, you don't have to worry. So coming to the present question, x mod sine x. X is a very simple polynomial. It's continuous and differentiable everywhere. Mod sine x alone is not differentiable at all multiples of pi, pi, 2 pi, 3 pi, 0, minus pi, minus 2 pi, so on. Whenever you take one is differentiable and another one is not differentiable, whether product is differentiable or not, it may be, may not be. In addition, it is not. And I have two functions sum. If this is differentiable, when I have sum of two functions, if f is differentiable, g is differentiable, definitely f plus g is differentiable. If this is differentiable, this is differentiable, f plus g is differentiable. When this is not differentiable, this is not differentiable, there are two choices. It may be differentiable, may not be differentiable. Same thing with continuity. When this is continuous, this is continuous, the sum is continuous. When this is not continuous, this is not continuous, their sum may be continuous, may not be continuous. But one is differentiable, one is not differentiable. Definitely their sum is non-differentiable only. Same thing with continuity. One is continuous, one is not continuous. Their sum is definitely not continuous. But we cannot say that for product. This may be differentiable, this may not be differentiable. The product may be differentiable, may not be differentiable. Okay, we can easily adjust questions where it will happen or it will not happen. So here, I know mod sin x is not differentiable at all, pi, 2 pi, 3 pi, 0. But x into mod sin x, whether it is not or not, I have to check. I can use first or without principle also. Okay. So let us take, let x equal to k pi. Then what is f dash x or k pi? Continuity, I don't have to check, it is continuous. So f dash a formula is limit x tends to a. F of x minus f of k by x minus. So if you want f dash k pi, it is a limit x tends to k pi. We'll get here x mod sin x. Here k pi minus mod sin k pi by x minus k pi. But sin k pi is 0. Sin pi or 2 pi or 3 pi is 0. This is gone. So we are left with this part. Limit x tends to k pi x mod sin x by x minus k. I am going to take x minus k pi as t. Then it will come limit t tends to 0. This x will become t plus k pi. And wherever x is there, I have to write t plus k pi. Sin t plus k pi, if it is t plus pi, sin t plus pi is minus sin t. Sin t plus 2 pi is plus sin t, but doesn't matter, mod will take care of that. So whether you take sin 180 plus theta or 360 plus theta or 540 plus theta, it may be plus sin theta or minus sin theta, but mod, so you are going to get mod sin t by t. Now this limit doesn't exist at least one place. We'll see what is that. And t is positive, that is 0 plus, when you take, I have to remove mod sin t and write plus sin t, this limit will be plus 1. Okay, so limit t tends to 0 plus, when I take, this will be plus 1. And here when I put 0, answer will be k pi. So the right hand derivative at any k pi to the function x mod sin x is k pi. What is the limit t tends to 0 minus? Just before 0, sin t is negative. So when I remove the mod, I'll get minus 1, minus sin t by t. That will be minus 1. And here t is 0 only, so I'll get a minus k pi. Okay. So whether you take at pi or 2 pi or 3 pi, the right hand derivative will come. For example, if you take 3 pi, right hand derivative is 3 pi, left hand derivative is minus 3 pi. If you take 5 pi, right hand derivative is 5 pi, left hand derivative is minus 5 pi. If you take pi, right-hand derivative is pi, left-hand derivative is minus pi. If you take minus 3 pi, right-hand derivative is minus 3 pi, left-hand derivative is plus 3 pi. Whatever it is, they are not equal. But they are one time they are equal, that is when k is 0. Okay. So left-hand derivative is not equal to right-hand derivative for all k belongs to z, integers, except 0. Because when k is 0, right hand derivative is also 0, left hand derivative is also 0. Same thing you can see another way. x sin mod sin x at any particular interval, or that when you take a multiple of pi, just after multiple of pi, it may be x sin x positive and minus x sin x. When I differentiate this, I will get x cos x plus sin x. When I differentiate this, minus x cos x plus sin x. If you take pi or 2 pi or 3 pi or 4 pi, this is 0 gone. But this will be plus 3 pi, this will be minus 3 pi, this will be minus 3 pi, this will be plus 3 pi. They're different. But at 0, this is also 0, this is also 0. Okay, so mod sin x alone, it is not differentiable at 0, pi, 2 pi, 3 pi, minus pi, minus 2 pi, minus 3 pi, so on. But this total, it is differentiable at 0, but not at pi, 2 pi, 3 pi, so on. Are everybody able to understand, or shall I give a simpler example, some more simple examples? Tenth question, the answer is option B. F is differentiable for all except at n pi, where n is plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2, plus or minus 3. All integers but not 0. Okay, so I should explain with some examples. Okay, so k pi, if somebody is not able to relate, I'll check at 2 pi or 3 pi or 5 pi, just for it. Okay, so first of all, x, we don't have any problem. There's no doubt. Mod sin x, we know. The graph is like this. At all these multiples of pi, right hand derivative, left hand derivative are different because there's a sharp change, and that tells you that they are not differentiable, because right hand derivative slope of this, left hand derivative slope of this. Okay, let us check at zero what is happening. Let us say I want to find f dash zero. Limit x tends to zero, f of x minus f of zero by x minus zero, which is limit x tends to zero. X mod sin x minus 0 by x. This x you can cancel. We'll get limit x mod sin x. Mod sin x is 0 only, no problem. Whether you take 0 plus or 0 minus 0. So f dash 0 nicely exists. If I take f dash pi, let us see what happens. Limit x tends to 0. Same again, f of x minus f of pi by x minus pi. And what is our f of x? X mod sin. So limit, this is also pi. So limit x tends to pi. I'm using limit x tends to a, f of x minus f of a by x minus a. That is the formula for f dash a. Okay. So what is f of x? X mod sin. What is f of pi? 0, because sin pi is 0, by x minus pi. Now, how to deal with it? Limit x tends to pi. I want to take pi minus x as t here. Or x minus pi as t. X minus pi as t. X is equal to pi plus t. Then, when x is tending to pi, t will tend to 0. Limit t tends to 0. X will be pi plus t. Sin x will be sin 180 plus theta minus sin theta, but mod will make it sin t. And down is t. There's a mod sin. Now, when I take 0 plus, this limit will be sin t by t 1, and this will be pi, so it will be pi plus 0 into 1. When I take 0 minus, this will be minus sin t when you remove mod. I'll get minus 1 here, pi plus 0 into minus 1. So right hand derivative is plus pi, left hand derivative is minus pi. They are not equal, so it is not differentiable. Instead of pi, if I take 2 pi, would have got right hand derivative 2 pi, left hand derivative minus 2 pi. If I take 3 pi, like that. So this one is not differentiable at all, 0, pi, 2 pi, 3 pi, so on. But among them, at 0, this product is differentiable, but not at pi, 2 pi, 3 pi, so on. Is this okay? Tanush? without using first principle, I said another way is directly differentiate this. But taking two cases, when x is more, okay, you take any k pi, after k pi it will be x sin x maybe, before k pi it is minus x sin x or vice versa, this can come here, this can come here. The derivative of this is x cos x plus sin x. Derivative of this is minus x cos x minus sin x. When you substitute pi or 2 pi or 3 pi, this is 0, they are gone. But these two are different. When you substitute 2 pi, this will be plus 2 pi, this will be minus 2 pi. When you substitute 3 pi, this is minus 3 pi, this is plus 3 pi. But when you substitute 0, because of this x, this is 0, this is 0. So only at 0 they are equal, at pi, 2 pi, 3 pi, 4 pi, these two are different. This is without using first principle, directly applying UV rule. That way. Is it okay? Dhanush, is the second explanation understood? Okay. So next question also is based on that only. I don't know whether I can complete, but at least I can start this question. This is also about differentiability. Okay. Let us see only cos pi by x. How is the graph of this? After 2, this is 0, this is 2. This is the graph after 2. I'm trying to understand y equal to cos pi x, how it is. Y at 2, it is cos 90, cos pi by 2, 0. When you take anything from 2 to infinity, pi by x will be from pi by 2 to 0. When x changes from 2 to infinity, pi by x will change from pi by 2 to 0. I know cos 90 is 0 and cos 0 is 1. So when x tends to infinity, pi by x will tend to 0 and cos 0 will tend to 1. So it is trying to touch that one line. But between 0 to 2, this will oscillate so many times. Because when x is between 0 to 2, pi by x is between infinity to 2, pi by 2. All right. So it will oscillate anyway. This is the first quadrant, I think, here. Between 2 to 1, it will be pi by 2 to pi. Pi by 2 to pi is second and third, cos is negative. It will be like this, then it will be like this, then it will be like this, then it will be like this. So the more you come closer to zero, it oscillates more faster, you keep on oscillating. Now, if you take a mod, this will go up, okay? Where you will come like this, so many things. And then this will remain, this will also come up, but this will remain as it is. After two, no problem, it is always differentiable. But here, there will be sharp change at all these places. So if you take mod cos pi by x alone, it is not differentiable at all these places. I can say what they are. This is 2 and this is not 1. This is 1.